series. Today's webinar series is about general exception in IPC. Again, a topic which is very general, but as we are doing from the beginning, that we will try to approach through Bayer Act. So obviously we know what is general exception, how it plays, what is its role, everything we know about general exception. But our focus in this series is about more upon how the language of Bayer Act is being interpreted differently by the time being by Supreme Court and other judgments also. So before getting into, there are a few questions which you can answer. There are a few questions for about general exception. Why they are called general exceptions? We are doing general exceptions of IPC. When I say general exception of IPC, I basically means Chapter 4 of IPC. Chapter 4 of IPC means Section 76 to 106. So in IPC, Chapter 406 or Chapter 76, Section 76 to 106, Chapter 4 talks about all this. Before entering into this, why it is called general exception? Try to find out. We should know that what, why we call it general exception. Anyone in the meeting can tell me or write me why we called it general exception. Why the word general exception is being used in IPC? Why? Well, try to understand. Suppose, let us pick up the example. A is being charged for, not commit, I will use, A is being accused of theft. Okay, so A has been accused of theft, and now what he is doing in theft, accused of theft, A want to prove that he acted bona fide in mistake. Can you tell me? Or you want to prove case of mistake of fact? Can he do so? Can he give the general defense? This is a defense. Defense under Section 76. So you want to take the defense. It, generally, we are taking about general. He can, bound by law. We are not talking about that part also. I am asking, A want to take a defense of general exception under theft. Can he take the defense of general exception under theft? Answer is yes. Try to understand. This is the answer. Try to understand why the word general exception is used. Try to understand. For example, it is something like this. For example, suppose section 1, section 2, section 3, and so on, section 511. We have these much sections in IPC. What this chapter is basically saying, what this chapter is basically doing, what it is doing, they use the word general exception. Why they use the word general exception? This basically they mean says after every section, 76 to 106 is to be read. So basically, these are the exception to every offense. Section 76 to 106 are exception to every offense in IPC. That is why they call general exceptions. So whether it is a case of theft, whether it is a case of rape, it is offense, whether it is a case of robbery, dacoity, murder, criminal breach of trust, mischief, criminal force, anything, trespass, any offense will be subject to general exception. So in order they could have right. What basically is possible? Suppose they would have right after every these general exception are basically the provisos of every section. So if IPC could be written like this, that are after every section these 76 to 106 is to be written. So if the framer of the IPC easily make it as easy for us, because this is common exceptions, so they create a different chapter. If they could not have done this, so after every offense these could be the exception, so our IPC can be this much. In order to make it easy for us, what they do, they put it in a general exception chapter. And if you read section 6 of IPC, so you will find that section 6 make the declaration that general exception applies upon every offense of IPC. This is the general exception applies on whole IPC. When I say whole IPC, means on every offense. This is why they are called general exception. Now you understand why they are called general exception, because this generally applies to every offense. So if the conditions are fulfilled, obviously if the conditions are fulfilled. So why they are called general exception? This, it generally applies on each and every offense available. One thing is clear. Nay, IT Act, we are not talking about IT Act right now. 76 to 106 is basically applicable to IPC. I'm talking about IPC. Obviously, Section 6, if you read the definition of Section 6, they defined every offense. So IT Act defined every offense, or other laws defined. So Section 40 defines what do you mean by offense? Other laws. So obviously, Section 76 to 106 applies to certain other offenses also. But it depends upon law, in which law it is applicable. Whereas generally, if I talk, yes, they are applicable to other offenses also. But our focus right now is on IPC, right? So for Ayush, for your answer, IT Act, yes, it will apply, right? So you understand this, why they are called general exception. Because they generally applies on every offense that you read. So the answer to this is lying under section 106. Up next question is, which I practically come into mind. When they are applicable to every offense, okay, to let it be theft, let it be robbery, let it be rape, let it be murder, any, let it be any. If they are applicable upon every act, my question is this, does a court have to presume? Court have to presume that general exception fall under each case? Who has the duty bound? Try to understand before getting the general exception. One thing is clear, that the law of general exception applies generally on every offense of IPC or any other offense. Section 6 make a declaration, and that is why they are called general exception. That is, they are applicable generally to all law. This is the first situation. Second situation, my question raises, ki if they are applicable to every offense, so whenever any offense came to a court, is it a duty of the court to find out whether it is a case of general exception or not? Will court every time be screening a section 76 to 106 and then only it will go into the ingredients of offense? So, for example, the court has, in court, the case of theft has come, or a case of rape has been come, or murder has come. So, would court do the screening? Would court see 76 to 106 first, whether it is a case of defense, insanity, intoxication, concern, voluntary non-fit injuria, private defense, so on? Will it check all these, and then after, if it does not fall in any of these sections, then only it will go into the main offense and try to put the accused into main offense? Will it, this the scenario? Is it the duty of the court to find out the general exception? Answer is no. It is a duty of the, it is a duty of the party to raise general exception. First, So it is not the duty of the court to raise general exception. Rather, it is the duty of a party to raise. So whosoever want to plead general exception have to raise the general exception. Now, next question. Suppose if party has raised general exception, then if party has raised the question of general exception, then what will happen? Will court presume the general exception? Will court presume the existence of general exception? That means will court presume that yes, because this person is pleading now, we says that general exception is existing, and now it is the duty of the opponent party to prove that the general exception is not existing. Will such presumption be allowed? Answer is no. Section 105 Indian Evidence Act says burden of proof of general exception is on the person who pleads so. One thing is clear, that neither it is the duty of the court to plead to raise the general exception, firstly. Secondly, moreover, if general exception is being raised by any party, then it is the duty of the court to presume that the general exception is not existing. And it is the 105 gives the power to the court. Court to presume that general exception does not exist. So every time, whenever general exception is being pleaded by any party, the court will presume that there is no existence of general exception. The court will presume that general exception is not existing. Rather, it is a burden of the proof upon the court party to prove that yes, there is a general exception. Right. So this much is clear. Before getting into general exception, the idea of general exception is being made clear. So how it works and how it happens. So now we will try to focus upon more important sections, because we have 2 days for general exception. So my focus will be on the core area of general exception, which you must know, which includes so much of concept. So let us bring up the conceptual part of the general exception. So I will start with section 84. And this is very important section for understanding, needs a lot of concept. So we will be focusing upon section 84. Section 84 talk about unsoundness of mind, an offense, an act committed by an unsound person. Unsoundness is a defense. Unsoundness of mind is a defense. And this is how it become a defense. That is given under section 84. We will try to find out. So general basic concept of general exception is clear. Let us go into section 84. Let us open the Bayer Acts and try to find out what is the general exception is saying about all this. Let us read section 84 first. I'm reading section 84 for you people. If you have a Bayer Act, please open it. It's good. Nothing is an offense which is done by a person who, at the time of doing it by reason of unsoundness of mind, is incapable of knowing the nature of the act, or that he is doing what is either wrong or contrary to law. Right? Understand, there are some ingredients. Let us write the ingredient of this. So how you'll find out whether a defense of is of unsound. So suppose A have murdered B. Suppose A murdered B. And he pleads unsoundness. Mere pleading of unsoundness is not enough. You have to prove it. How to prove? this is given under section 84. Section 84 says, dekhiye, I'm reading it again and bringing out the ingredients out of it. This is nothing is an offense. When nothing is an offense, what do you mean by nothing is an offense? Basically, this means an act or omission. Act or omission. Suppose this is an act of an individual and omission. Omission means a duty to do something and is not performing that. So act of any person or an omission of person is not an offense. Is not offense. Then nothing is an offense which is done by a person. Done by a person. So basically section 84 applies upon the act or omission done by human being. It's an act of human being, first of all. It should not be the act of any animal or animal. So the act or omission is being done by the human being itself. Section 84 applies only upon the human beings. Then this is at the time of doing. This is at the time of doing it. At the time of doing it. And these ingredients are very important to prove your case. At the time of doing it, what does it mean? This means the unsoundness of an individual must exist at the time of offense. The unsoundness must exist at time of offense. So when, first of all, section 84 will give you a defense only when you prove that you were unsound at the time when you were committing the offense. You were unsound past or you were unsound in later on? No. Suppose this is an act. This is an act. Iske pehle ka unsoundness aur iske baad ka unsoundness have no value. To aap pehle se kabhi unsound hai? You are being unsound from the very beginning in past and you are continuing to be unsound mind? Doesn't matter. You are still into unsound state? Doesn't matter. You have to prove this. This particular time period when you were doing the offense. The point at which you were committing an offense, you were of unsound. Okay. Next. I'm reading. Nothing is an offense which is done by a person who at the time of doing or by reason of unsoundness of mind. Okay. The time of doing by reason of unsoundness of by reason of unsoundness of mind. So this is this unsoundness. What do you mean by unsoundness? What do you mean by unsoundness of mind? The word unsoundness of mind, we will understand everything, don't worry. Unsoundness of mind means unfit state of mind. Unfit state of mind. Incapability of a mind to think. Okay. So this is a state of mind. They're saying that at the time you are committing the offense, you were into a state of mind. What? Which state of mind? You are into a unsoundness of a state of mind. So you were unsound at the time of offense. Or what happened due to this unsoundness? This is, read further. This is unsoundness of mind, incapable to know the nature of act. This unsoundness has resulted into incapable to know what? The nature of act. You were incapable to understand the nature of act firstly. Then this is or that he is doing what is either wrong, that he is doing wrong. He is doing either wrong or contrary to law. And this is important. Now everything is. So I have fixed it out. I have bring it out so many ingredients to you. Try to understand what these ingredients are basically. So what this is saying? They are saying any person has committed an act of omission. And while the act of omission was committed, at that point of time, he was unsoundness of mind. This unsoundness of mind basically means medically unfit. Try to understand. Very important now. It is very important to understand. This unsoundness of mind means medical unfit. Medically unfit. He was medically unfit at the time when he was doing the act. And due to this medical unfitness, he does not understand. He is incapable to know the nature of the act, doing either wrong or contrary to law. This is known as legally unsound. This is known as legally unsound. Try to understand. I'm taking you to a different perspective. Section 84 deal with two type of unsoundness. One is known as medical unsoundness and another is known as legal unsoundness. What this is saying, I thought section, if you break out, if you break down the section basically talk about that due to unsoundness of mind, this is known as medical insanity. And due to this, person is incapable. Where the incapable to understand the nature wrong or contrary to law. This green part is known as legally unsound. You will understand what you mean by legal unsoundness, what do you mean by medical unsoundness, and what is the requirement of this? Okay, how you will prove this? So one thing is clear that section 84, two type of unsoundness is there. One is known as legal and another is known as, so first of all, let us discuss medical unsoundness. Medical insanity. I will use the word unsound of mind. Unsoundness of mind. This is the first. So in order to obtain the benefit of section 84, the person must prove firstly that he was suffering from some medical insanity. What do you mean by medical insanity? Medical insanity. That means you have to prove, you have to give medical evidence. Of doctor. The doctor will give the report, first of all. So whenever you want to take the benefit of section 84, prima facie necessity that you must have, that you should have a report of a doctor who will conclude that yes, at the time when the act was committed, this person was unsoundness of. How this report will come, obviously doctor will do so many tests and everything. Out of that test, he will give the result. First of all, you have to prove medical insanity. So this is the first thing. But mere having a certificate of doctor that yes, he is medically unfit will not give you the defense of section 84. What this is? This is due to unsoundness of mind. Once you have this document, you have to prove that due to this unsoundness, you are incapable to know. What do you mean by incapable to know? Incapable. They are not saying that, they are not using the word the person do not know. They are using the word incapable to know. This means now you prove the surrounding, this incapable to know means you prove by surrounding circumstances. this is now bows by surrounding circumstances. Now you prove to us that you are incapable to know first nature of the offense. Nature of act. What do you mean by nature of act? What do you mean by nature of the act? What does mean? What do you mean by nature of the act? What do you mean by this nature of that? That you are not able to understand what you are doing is capable. You are not capable to understand what are you doing right or wrong. Not capable to understand what you are doing is right or wrong. So now from the surrounding circumstances, advocate will try to prove firstly that he has already having a medical certificate that he has, a person has acted due to the unsoundness of mind. Thirdly, this nature of the unsoundness was such that this that the person doing the act was not knowing what he is doing. For example, if I take up the example, a man cut the head of the wife. So man cut the head of the wife and put into the almirah, and thereby in the morning he was searching the head of the wife and asking, I have put the head for rest and why am I not finding it? So I have put the head of my wife into the rest, but I'm not finding it where it is. What this shows, what this shows, that he's not even knowing that what he has committed is a right or wrong. Similarly, a man gave a bali, okay, to the of a son to Kali or to some Bhagwan and starts shouting into the path of Bhagwan, I have given my son and now he is like, he live forever. What is this? This person act is showing that he is not aware what he has committed. So first of all, you have to now prove two things. First, unsoundness of mind. Second, nature of the act. This is nature of the act. After that we'll say or. We use the word or. Why this is or? They are saying if you are not able to prove the nature of act, so you prove what? You prove or prove either wrong or contrary to law. Contrary to law. This is if you are not able to prove this or word given option. This is optional. That means either you prove this. And if you're not proving this, then you come to this second option. So either you prove that due to unsoundness of mind, this person was incapable to understand the nature of it. If you fail to do so, then you prove that he was incapable to know that he is doing something wrong or contrary to it. Either wrong. What do you mean by wrong? Wrong means something moral, morally wrong. Or contrary to law, that is something prohibited by law. Sare log bear act dekhiyega, please. Very important to understand. They are saying either you prove wrong or contrary. They are using either or. Very important to know. And IPC section 84 is very important to understand on this perspective that if you see the bear act, they are using, again, I am reading it for you people, please focus upon your Bear Act and we will understand the later part other also. Shepani, I will give your answer. Take care, don't worry. I will give your answer later on. I am reading it again. Incapable of knowing the nature of the act or that he is wrong, what is either, that he is doing, what is either wrong or contrary to law. Try to understand. First, you prove that it is the nature of the act you don't know. If you fails to prove this, then you will go into the latter part and you will prove either wrong or contrary to law. Now my question is this. Do you have to prove these two separately or all together? This part of medical sanity must exist together. Together. This either or is to be read as and, not or, remember. It is to be read as and. Instead of either or, you prove and. That means you have to prove both altogether. that he was acting contrary to law or wrong, both. I know so many people have not understand. We will take it again, don't worry. So first of all, try to understand, this is section 84. Section 84 talks about unsoundness, insanity, I will say, no? Insanity. And in this insanity, it creates two barriers. One is known as medical insanity. And another is known as, legal insanity. My voice is clear. Rahul, Mohit, have your voice again, please, Peter. Right. Try to understand. What happened? In order to achieve the benefit of Section 84, you have to pass out these barriers. So first of all, you have to clear the first barrier, medical insanity, that is known as unsoundness of mind. This is known as unsoundness of mind. This is the first barrier, you have to clear it. And how you will clear it? By giving medical evidence. By giving the medical report, you will clear this barrier. Once you are clear with this barrier, now you will go into another barrier that is known as legal insanity. Legal insanity consists of two windows. There is a two windows. One window, first window is known as nature of act. So either you go by this window and you prove the nature of that. If you proved, this is the defense. You will get the defense. And another window is the second window. Second window consists of two holes, two loops. This second window consists of two loops, one and two. You have to prove both the loops. And which are these two loops? Wrong and contrary to. If you prove these loops, if you go into this and prove both the loops and move forward, reach here, get the defense. Right. So either you fall into first loop with a single, you fall into first window with a single loop, that is nature of that, or you go into a second window with a two loops. Okay. And you will get the defense. Generally, one bifurcation has been understood. One thing is, Ayush, I will answer this, don't worry. One thing is clear. So first of all, so let it be medical insanity. So once you have proved the medical insanity, you will go into first nature of that. And you, if you proved that the person was not able, due to this medical insanity, person was not aware what he is doing. He will get the defense. But suppose you are not able to fall into this, not able to prove. Rahila Lal asking, unsoundness of mind differ from lunacy? Yes, exactly. Unsoundness of mind and lunatic is a little different. Lunatic will fall under unsoundness of mind. Okay, so if you understand, unsoundness of mind is broader than lunatic. The lunatic will be covered under unsoundness of mind if it is medically being proved, right? So I'm using unsoundness of mind. IPC has used unsoundness of mind to cover everything. So I am a normal person, but there might be a chance due to anger. I lost my control of mind. I may not be lunatic, but I may become unsound. Okay, so lunatic is one of the conditions of unsoundness of mind. Whereas unsoundness of mind is very broader. So it is not required that I should be pagal every time. What is required is at the time when I was doing the act, at that time I was pagal. At that time I was not into my stable state of mind. And this can be proved by evidence of doctor. If this is proved, then first I go into, so suppose I have proved the defense of that medical insanity. Now I have to take the defense of legal insanity. Then while going into a legal insanity, I have option. First option that I will prove that I don't know the nature of that. When I say nature of that, that means through surrounding circumstances, the person can prove. Does being conscious or unconscious while doing an act is I use conscious or unconsciousness of mind is a very different concept. You may be conscious. Obviously, you're doing something is a conscious. What is important is your consciousness is not aware that what you are doing. Right? Obviously, you cannot do anything in unconscious state of mind. That is intoxication. You are being very into senses, but your senses are not knowing what you are doing. Okay, that is a very different state of mind. So this is medical insanity is not easy to achieve. And once you achieve it, section 84 always you find while you are reading section 84 in your college, you always find it's very easy to prove that yeah, okay, he was mad. In like movies, they say he pagal tha. Hey, this is not like pagal tha. Once you prove the medical insanity, you go into second. Either first you go into nature of the act. What do you mean by nature of the act? This is known as medical insanity. By the nature of the act, you mean that you will prove that while this person was doing the act, which has already been proved, he was medically unfit while doing this act. That means he was not aware what he is doing. Consciously, he was working on it, but his mind is not in his control. And plus, he was also not knowing that what will be the consequences of this act. The don't know the nature of the act means not aware about the consequences. Okay. And do not worry about Ayush Nanavati case ko nahi padenge. That is a very different case. Okay. That not knowing about the nature of the case. For example, I give you an example. That suppose X cut wife into pieces, and after cutting the wife into pieces, he start making a food of it. So what is happening? Suppose medical insanity has been taken. Now his act, does it act shows that he know the nature? No, his act is very clear that he's not knowing what he's doing. Similarly, a boy cut his the head of a wife and take it to the sauce and says, change it. She talks so much, please give me the another head so that I could put on my wife. What is he doing? He's not knowing the nature of the act. The nature of the act will be discovered from the surrounding circumstances. The manner this person is acting on the offense will show the nature of the act. Okay, if you are able to prove this, you will get the defense under section 84. But suppose you are not able to prove, then you will go into a second part. In second part, you have to prove two things. First, to prove that it is wrong. When I say wrong, that is morally wrong. So incapable to know. When you have not able to prove the nature of the act, if you're not able to prove the nature of the act, now you can go into this or word has been used. This or word means now you can go into this second phase. If you are able to fail the first, you go into second. And in second, you have to prove first one thing, that what this person has done is not knowing that it is morally wrong. That means he is not knowing what he has done is morally wrong. It has been stopped by sub law. And after that, plus contrary to law. He is also not aware that it is contrary to law. That he is not aware it is contrary to law. For example, suppose A give a bali to his son, and that after giving bali, so he is giving a bali to the son, it is morally wrong. So his act of giving bali is per se shows, so sacrifice, act of sacrificing a son into onto the name of God. So if person tries to sacrifice a son onto the name of God, or he sacrifices his son onto the name of God, what this shows, that he's not aware that he is doing something which is morally incorrect. Obviously, no society requires. Or for example, somebody tried to send his wife for sati, or daughter-in-law for sati. This is morally wrong. He's not knowing morally wrong, firstly. Secondly, after this cutting or sacrificing the son, he comes to the wife and told that you make good food. Our son has achieved something great and he will come down to eat the food from the god. Now, what is this? He is telling everything to the wife with so much power that he is not aware that he has done something wrong in which a punishment can be given him to him. For example, this person who sacrificed the boy come to the masjid and he start making announcement that upon the Eid, I have sacrificed my son and I have followed the provisions of my God, Allah. May Allah live long. Now, what is this? He's making announcements. His act of announcement is showing that he don't know that he has done something which is prohibited by law and he may get punishment. So contrary to law means prohibited by law. If these two things prove together, he will get the difference. Or if no, he will not get the difference. How many people have understood this? So in order, Abhito, I'm just making Ayush, I will give you answer of this. Abhito, I'm just trying to give you the how you will obtain the defense of Section 84. If I pick up, so if suppose this is suppose one is medical insanity, and after this, you have to prove this. Suppose this is proved, then you have to follow the provision of this nature of act, wrong, and contrary to law. And last, here you will get the defense. So suppose if you prove wrong, but you are not able to prove contrary to law or wrong, still you will get the defense. You fail to prove nature of act, but you are able to prove wrong and contrary to law, both, you will get the defense. And this is how you will get the defense. So you will have the defense after proving medical insanity. You have to fall into these two, then only you will get it. Like, now you can ask me that question. This is insanity. Not easy, no? It's the toughest thing to follow. Now question I can ask, I can give you the answer to the questions. Few people have asked me. Ayushi has asked me a question. In Nanavati case, he had pleaded that he was of unsound mind as the knowledge of his wife affair disturbed his mind. Later, the court had said that he got sufficient time to cool down. In Nanavati case, I will not go into Nanavati case, it's a very different perspective. But Ayush, in Nanavati case, he was not given a defense of unsoundness of mind because he was not even able to prove medical insanity. So, for later stage of insanity, maybe to legal insanity, he might prove that he acted in a very fast, he was not aware anything. But medical insanity was not proved because he was into sound state of mind. He was knowing what he is doing. So medical insanity was not proved in this case. Ayush, unsoundness is bailable. What do you mean by unsoundness is bailable? It's a general defenses. So general defenses are not given under section CRPC. CRPC is given offenses. So in what offense you are claiming unsoundness of mind will decide whether it be a bailable or not. If Ayush is asking next question. If a person abets his son to commit a suicide, such person is unsound. Important is not this. If I abets my son to commit a suicide, I can claim unsoundness. But for the purpose of that, I have to prove. The point of time when I was abetting my son, I was not medically fit. Doctor will get the report, firstly. Secondly, I was not knowing the nature that what will be the consequence if my son commit the suicide. He will die, or I was not wrong contrary to law. That have to prove. Then only it will be decided. Okay. Any person having any other question? Abhinav is asking questions. So, sir, from this we can say that legal insanity furnishes a good ground of defense from criminal, while the medical does not. No. Ashish Vashne, try to understand both medical insanity and legal insanity when clubbed together will give the defense of Section 84. Neither medical insanity per se alone will give the defense, and neither the legal insanity will create the defense. So if you have only legal insanity but you are not having medical insanity, you will not get the defense. You are having only medical insanity but you are not having illegal insanity, you will not get the defense. For the purpose of defense, you must have both legal and medical insanity coexisting all together, and that too at the time when you have committed the offense, then only you will get the defense. So these three things must exist: that medical and legally unsound, plus the unsoundness exists at the time when the offense was committed, not prior nor later. Prior or later insanity does not affect it. Right. Sir, is any difference between idiot and unsoundness? Lunatic, idiots, unsoundness, they are only the one of the dimension of unsoundness of mind. So by using the word unsoundness under section 84, we have broadened the definition. So idiot, lunatic, a general person like me can fall under section 84. Don't worry, because they are not saying any person was previously unsound, any person was later on unsound. So somebody can be an idiot who is not into our senses, but at the time when he was committed an offense, he very well aware what he is doing. Similarly, a person who may be of a sound mind, but due to some particular point of time, he lost his senses and he's not knowing what he is doing. He may become unsound. Okay. So obviously, unsoundness is a broader definition. How does the doctor determine this thing has already existed in the past, committed in the past? There are certain tests. Don't worry. Nalini Pandey, there is a test for this. In order to determine the medical unsoundness of any person, doctors do commit certain tests and we get to know whether this person exists at the time where the offense was committed, he was into a sense. So doctor do medical tests upon him, acts upon, there are so many factors which result into proof medical insanity, right? Hopefully you have understand the meaning of medical unsoundness and legal. So you have done with the concept of unsoundness of the mind. How many people have understood this? I will pick up from here only tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll have one long class. We will be doing intoxication. I want to do intoxication today only, but we don't have enough time to start and end it up. We'll be doing intoxication and some part of general defense. I will be clarifying bound by law and justified by law. So tomorrow we'll be doing basic important sections, like what is the difference between 76 and 79. Justified by law, bound by law. We will doing 86 and 85, the difference. Intoxication and 86 kind intoxication. What is the difference between voluntary and involuntary intoxication? We will also be doing section 80, accident. And we will be doing certain sections of private defense. How the private defense is being used. Basically, what are the exceptions of private defense we will doing. Okay? What is the extent of private defense? We will be doing that part tomorrow. Don't worry, though I will do.